Okay, so the last talk will be about applications to geometry, and we've seen a number of examples of path algebras of quivers with relations and their deformations, and these path algebras of quivers of relations also appear in the context of algebraic geometry. And so if we have an algebraic variety X over a field of characteristic zero, algebraically closed, then X sometimes admits what's called a tilting bundle. And that means that the bundle sort of generates the derived category of X, and it has no higher self-extensions. And it's also a compact object. And in this case, the tilting bundle T induces a derived equivalence between the derived category of X and the derived category of A, where A is the endomorphism algebra of the tilting bundle. And so this endomorphism algebra can be written as path algebra of a quiver with relations. And so this this derived equivalence actually lifts to an equivalence of DG categories. And so so in particular, it also induces an isomorphism on the Hochschild cohomologies. And so this is not just an isomorphism of of vector spaces of the Hochschild cohomologies, but actually this is an isomorphism of B infinity algebras in the category, homotopy category of B infinity algebras. And so there's in particular the deformation theory of sort of several related objects are equivalent. And so this is work by Keller and Lohan Vandenberg. And so we have sort of two sides here. One is the sort of geometric side here on the left, and one is a more algebraic side. And so here we have deformations of the abelian category of coherent sheaves as abelian category on the left here. And here we have, can look at the structure sheaf and look at deformations as a twisted pre-sheaf. So these two types of deformations are actually equivalent. And actually we can also restrict the structure sheaf to an affine open cover, which is closed under intersections. And this gives a diagram of commutative algebras in this case. And so the deformations of this diagram of algebras, this was also studied by Gerstenhaber Schack. So you can look at associative deformations of this diagram of algebras. And this point of view is also equivalent to the other ones. And from this diagram algebra, you can also define, from this diagram of algebras, you can define an associative algebra, which is called the diagram algebra, also introduced by Gerstenhaber Schack. And this, again, is an equivalence of deformations. And so on the right-hand side, here we have the abelian category of modules, here finitely generated modules, for example. And the deformations of this abelian category are equivalent to deformations of A as associative algebra. Okay, and now in the context of the previous slide, A could be the endomorphism algebra of a tilting bundle, which you can write as a quiver, it's path algebra of a quiver with relations. And so that's this part here. And And actually, in this picture, there's another part where path algebras of quivers with relations appear, and that's this part down here. So the diagram algebra can also be written as the path algebra of a quiver with relations. And so this allows us to relate sort of algebraic deformations of KQ mod I now also to geometry and try to understand what this means on the geometric side. Okay, and so to get a feel of what sort of things one should look at from the point of view of geometry, is that we look at the Hochschild cohomology, which is the sort of first order deformations up to equivalence. And if X is smooth, then we have a decomposition theorem called the Hochschild-Constant-Rosenberg theorem. And this gives an isomorphism as follows. So we have the second Hochschild cohomology of the variety. And this now decomposes into three summands. And the first summand here, these are sections of the second exterior power of the tangent bundle. Because I denote tilting bundle by T, here I call it tangent bundle theta. And so these global sections are just global bivector fields. And when you do the formal deformation theory, this will correspond to quantizations of some Poisson structures. And so the second summand here, H1 of the tangent bundle, is also known to control the deformations as a variety. And then the third summand here corresponds to so-called twists. And so trying to interpret this in terms of the diagram, we can have a diagram of algebras you get by restricting the structure sheaf to affine open cover. And then on each open set, you have a commutative algebra, the algebra of regular functions on this open set. And you can do a deformation of this algebra here. Right, and this will in general be a non-commutative deformation. So if you look here at the second part, you can look at deformations of the variety itself. And so this will, in terms of the diagram, this will not change the commutativity of the algebras on the open sets, but it will deform how they sort of fit together. So you can think of it as changing the gluing of these open sets. And then the sheaf condition says that there's the commutative diagram, so restricting from one set to smaller sets to the intersection should commute, so it should be the identity, but you can also deform this. So this is this twist part here. Okay. And now if X is smooth and affine, then the higher sheaf cohomology vanishes. And so we only have the term H0 here. And so deformations in this case correspond to quantizations of some Poisson structure. And so in particular, if X is just the affine n space, then the these two points of view coincide, because the diagram algebra coincides with the endomorphism algebra of the tilting bundle, which is just the trivial bundle or the structure sheaf on AN. And so, as we've seen probably in all of the talks up to now, this we can write as a path algebra of a quiver with relations by choosing one vertex and then n loops at this vertex. And so for this, we have a nice reduction system where xj, xi gets reduced to xi, xj for j bigger than I. So this is the reduction system here. And this satisfies the diamond condition for this ideal here. And then we have the set of first entries, which are the elements we replace in the reductions. Okay, and as soon as n is big or equal to 3, we also have overlaps. And so the overlaps look like this, xk, xj, xi, where k is bigger than j is bigger than I. And so in this case, deformations may also be obstructed. Okay. And so now if we take a closer look of what this means on AN, we can have a bivector field just of the following form. So here, eta is a bivector field, and eta ij's, they are just functions, so polynomial coefficients. And then you have a wedge of these two tangent vectors. And given such a bivector field, we can directly associate an element in HOM KS to A. So this was sort of this term in the complex you get from this resolution of the associated to a reduction system. And so this was the same degree as the second Hochschild cohomology. Okay, and then we can send xj, xi, we just send it to the coefficient of this bivector. And now we also introduce a formal variable h bar. So this is now as an element in here, and for this we have a L infinity structure, and we can look at the Mauer-Carton equation. And so eta is a Poisson structure, so bivector field could or could not satisfy the Jacobi identity. And it does if and only if for these overlaps the Mauer-Carton equation holds modulo h bar cubed. So again here, we look at the overlaps where k is bigger than j is bigger than I. And then we look at associativity of these overlaps. And if this equation, which is equivalent to the Mauer-Carton equation, this equation holds to all orders, then star g, this combinatorial star product that we saw in the last two lectures, this is a deformation quantization of this Poisson structure. Okay, so here, that's what it says here. So if it's a Mauer-Carton element, then this is a quantization. And right, this equation we can sort of check by hand. And in particular, on A2, there are no overlaps. So this combinatorial star product can quantize any Poisson structure. And on A3, not all Poisson structures are Maurer-Cartan elements straight away. So if you put them here, we sort of put the Poisson structure in degree one in H bar. And if you compute these equations to a higher order, sometimes it's not satisfied at order H bar cubed, maybe. But so on A3, there's a classification of quadratic Poisson structures, and there are sort of 14 families of Poisson structures, and I think about half of them satisfy this Maurer-Cartan equation. So for at least for those, you could get a quantization of those Poisson structures sort of out of the box. Yes, and in general, you may have to add higher terms to G here, which is only degree one. You can try to add higher terms to make sure that it becomes a Maurer-Cartan element. And yeah, this can also be done sometimes, but we don't yet have a complete algorithm to do this for any Poisson structure. Okay. And so let me mention also Concevich's formula, which he used to prove his formality theorem, which I mentioned in the second talk. And so this formula is as follows. So if you have two functions A and B, you can look at the Concevich star product, which is defined as follows. So you you define a number of sort of a set of graphs, which are called admissible graphs. And the graphs sort of have one Poisson structure at the top, and then two arrows coming out of them that correspond to partial derivatives of the target. And so I've drawn sort of one of these graphs here. So here you would have the function A. Here would have the function B. And then here you sort of have the Poisson structure eta maybe sitting at one of these upper vertices, and then each arrow corresponds to a derivation of the target here with some labeling. And so there's a description of how to associate to such a graph, how to associate a bidifferential operator. So this is this B lambda here. This is a bidifferential operator acting on A and B, which will sit sort of in the graph at these two vertices at the bottom. And then there's a coefficient here. So this is the so-called weight or Concevich weight of this graph. And this is defined by embedding this graph into the upper half plane, and then using hyperbolic geometry there to get some angle form for each edge in the graph, and then wedging them and integrating over the configuration space of points, you get a real number, and this is the weight of this graph, and this enters here as a coefficient. And so these weights are sort of a bit mysterious, maybe. They're related to some motivic integrals and have recently been shown to be sort of multiple zeta values. And the reason I mention this here is that there's also a sort of similar graphical calculus for this for the star product, this combinatorial star product we defined, star G. And so the formula looks very similar. And so here A star G B is a sum over over graphs here. And then there's some bidifferential operator C pi. So here pi is also a graph. Actually it's the pair of a graph that appears in Concevich's formula. But the first entry will always be a graph without oriented cycles. So in Concevich's picture construction, you can have sort of graphs that looks like this maybe, and then there's an oriented cycle. And so these we do not get from reductions, but we do get some extra data we have to associate to the graph, which is a linear order of the incoming edges at each vertex. And so here, yeah, you have two incoming edges, and so that can either be ordered in the way I've drawn here or ordered in the other way. Okay, and so if this is a, if you have a Mao-Katon element for this L infinity algebra PQR tensor H bar, then this graphical formula already gives a quantization, a formula for the quantization of the Poisson structure corresponding to G1. And so G1 will be a Poisson structure. Right. And yes, and as was mentioned in the last talk, there's a question whether this star product maybe converges. And Concevich conjectures that his star product converges for quadratic Poisson structures on a small neighborhood of zero. And then he sort of writes that he expects that this to be true. So if you take y star x with his star product, Concevich star product, then you should get something like exponential of h bar xy. But because of the coefficients that appear in the formula here, these weights, actually this is not so easy to prove. Okay, and now we can also, of course, we have no overlaps, and on A2 we have no overlaps, so we can also give a different star product using this combinatorial star product. And in this case, we should choose G of Yx, sending Yx to xy h bar, because again we take the coefficient function of the bivector and put it here. And and in this case, if we try to compute the star product for two monomials, then we basically only have to reorder these, because the rule was we write them together and then we start interchanging them by doing reductions and sometimes replacing them by the old commutativity relations, and sometimes using this element G instead. Okay, and then we get sort of explicit formula at least for this Poisson structure on A2. Yes, and for two polynomials A and B, this is then also polynomial in H bar. And so particularly you can also evaluate this for all H bar. Okay, so let me also move on to the part where we discuss things which are not affine. And so if X is a variety which is not affine, then if it admits a tilting bundle, then this gives a very sort of compact description of the deformations of the category of coherent sheaves, for example, or of the diagram algebra. Of the diagram of algebras. And uh, Right, and the sort of the classical example of a variety with a tilting bundle is Pn, and P1 does not have any deformations. So the first example with deformations would be P2. And here we have a tilting bundle O plus O1 plus O2. And so it has three direct summons, and these direct summons correspond to the three vertices here. And then you have three arrows from O to O1, and then also three arrows from O1 to O2. And then they satisfy something like commutativity relations, because essentially the maps are given by multiplying by one of the homogeneous coordinates. And so these are like commutativity relations, but now they're sort of spread out along this acyclic quiver. Right, and this path algebra modulo, this ideal of relations, is the endomorphism algebra of the tilting bundle. And now we can try to understand the deformations. And so if we're given the reduction system, the set S of first entries is this xj yi with I smaller than j. And now we can look at the elements in HOM from ks to a. So we should look at the three elements in S. And now we have exactly, so there are nine paths of length two. So for example, this one here, and then this one, and so on. And three of them are reducible, and six of them are irreducible. And now we can use G and map to any linear combination of the irreducible ones. And so, if we consider G given as follows with 10 coefficients, lambda 1 up to lambda 10, then this actually gives these are co-cycles that give a basis of the Hochschild cohomology. So otherwise we would also have sort of terms here. So there are eight terms missing. HOM KS to A is actually 18 dimensional, but the cohomology is only 10 dimensional. So don't need to consider those, because they will be, the deformations will be equivalent if we add those co-boundaries. The Mao-Cartan equation is empty. There's no equation because there are no overlaps. And so we immediately get that that we can modify the ideal like this, and we get a 10-dimensional family of deformations. All of the algebras in the family will be 15-dimensional, like the original algebra. Now we can try to understand what this means in terms of geometry. So there's an explicit isomorphism induced by tilting between the Hochschild cohomology of the of this algebra A, which is the endomorphism algebra of the tilting bundle, and the Hochschild cohomology of P2, which by the Hochschild Constant-Rosenberg theorem is the global bivector fields on P2. And so this is also just the isomorphic to the global sections of O3. And so here you have cubic homogeneous polynomials. Okay, and so under this isomorphism, G is sent to the, so G as defined on the previous page here, G is sent to the to the cubic polynomial eta, which you get by multiplying each of the terms by some other linear monomial, and then just setting x, the x's equals to the y's, xi equals to yi, and then we get a cubic polynomial in x. And x0, x, x1, x2, which are the homogeneous coordinates of P2. And so locally, this means that if you look at the sort of standard open set here, locally you get this picture. So here eta was a cubic polynomial, and now we can dehomogenize that. And so this again is a cubic polynomial, but now in these local, in these two local coordinates. Okay, so this is the bivector field. So this gives a description of the deformation theory of the abelian category of quirin sheaves on P2. But it's not true that a variety always admits a tilting bundle. So then we can look at this this diagram algebra, which I mentioned on the second slide. And right, and what you do is you can take an affine open cover, right, and then you can restrict the structure sheaf to this open cover, and then you somehow build all this information into one big associative algebra. And so if you write this as the path algebra of a quiver with relations, then it looks like this. So here are maybe the open sets of Pn, and then there are the single intersections, and then the double intersections, and here at the end would be the intersection of all the open sets. And then on each open set, you sort of write the algebra of local functions as path algebra of a quiver with one vertex and loops. And so this gives you a big quiver like this. And then you have, for the diagram algebra, you have three types of relations. One which looks like commutativity of the restriction morphisms. And the other sort of relates the coordinates on one chart to the coordinates on another chart. And then here you have the commutativity relations, and then maybe also relations coming from given by some homogeneous polynomial if you cut out a variety in projective space. So the statement of this proposition is that if you have a projective variety which you've embedded into Pn, and you can take the open cover, the standard open cover of Pn, and restrict it to this variety X, and then the diagram algebra of X is actually the path algebra of a quiver of this sort of complicated quiver with these types of relations. Okay, and in particular, one can check that there's also a non-commutative Grüttner basis for this ideal here, giving a reduction system satisfying the Diamond condition. Okay, and so the reduction system looks like, if you basically, the idea is to use a nice order on the intersection here, and then make sure that everything is compatible in all directions. Okay, so this gives a nice reduction system, so we can also describe deformations of of this path algebra of Kruger with relations, which is deformations of the this diagram algebra. And so as you can see from the picture, this diagram algebra is much bigger than you'd want, maybe, but maybe this is all you can get in some situations. But one advantage the diagram algebra has that it's sort of very closely related to the geometry, right? So set that at these vertices here, you basically have the algebra on an affine open, algebra of regular functions, an affine open. So in this sense, it is more geometric. And so in the case of P2, we can take a look at the diagram algebra. And so here I want to choose a Poisson structure corresponding to this cubic polynomial. And the diagram algebra now looks like this. And so this quiver with relations as in the proposition. And so now here are sort of the affine open sets. So this is U0, U1, U2. And here would be like the intersection of U0 and U1. And under deformation, you can check that for this particular Poisson structure, what it does to this algebra here is that it deforms the commutative polynomial ring in two variables to sort of a quantum polynomial ring. And so the same happens on this vertex, and the same happens at this vertex. And so you can give deformation of the whole diagram algebra for P2. And it looks like a non-commutative projective plane, which is glued from three affine quantum planes. Okay. Okay. So this is this was trying to compare the diagram algebra and the algebra that you get from the endomorphism algebra of a tilting bundle. But here for P2, we only had one type of deformation because all of them sort of corresponded to quantizations of some Poisson structure. Because P2 doesn't have any commutative deformations and also no twists. And so now I want to, for the rest of the talk, I will focus on this family of examples, which have both commutative and non-commutative deformations geometrically. And so these are sort of resolutions of the 1 over k 1-1 surface singularity. So if we take a cyclic group of order k, so gamma cyclic group of order k, we can let it act on C2 by this. So so here's a 2x2 matrix diagonal entries omega omega. And here omega is a primitive kth root of unity. And so yeah, so maybe if this is not 1-1 but 1n, then you could also consider this case more generally. But let me talk about this case. So C2 mod gamma is then a toric singular affine variety, which is the 1 over k 1-1 singularity. And this has a resolution, a geometric resolution, a minimal resolution, which you can so get from toric geometry. So if the original singular fan was this here, then you can add a ray here, and then you get sort of two cones in the fan. And then the resolution is a quasi-projective variety, which is isomorphic to the total space of O minus K on P1. Okay. And now we have a tilting bundle on P1, the Balanchine tilting bundle on P1. One can check that the pullback of this bundle to this bigger space is also a tilting bundle on the bigger space on the resolution. And so the resolution is derived equivalent to this algebra A here. So here we have sort of the two direct summons, O and O1 on the resolution. So we have two vertices here. And then you can sort of see the P1 here, which are the two arrows in the one direction. So this here would be the endomorphism algebra of a tilting bundle on P1. But now you also have maps from, so on the bigger space on the resolution, you also have maps from O1 to O again, like here. And there's exactly K of them, and they also satisfy some relations. And so you should quotient by this idea of relations. And I've again marked which entries I want to be in the first entry of the reduction system and which in the second. So here the blue ones will be sort of the S's, and the greens the FS's. And right, and so this is the reduction system then that satisfies the diamond condition. So we can do this whole procedure of trying to find deformations by changing this ideal in a way that gives a nice deformation. Okay, so I should maybe also mention that for k equals 2, this is the pre-projective algebra of extended Dinkin diagram A1 that was mentioned in the last talk. Okay. Yes, so I should also point out that this A is actually what's called a reconstruction algebra that was introduced by Weems to describe the sort of non-commutative resolutions of these singularities. And so, yeah. These reconstruction algebras are defined in more generality again, but for this algebra, for this type of singularity, the algebra on the previous slide is exactly the reconstruction algebra. And now we can compute the second Hochschild cohomology of this algebra to see what kind of deformations we might expect. And as I said, now there are two summons here. So one summon here corresponds to the Poisson structures on the resolution. So these should be some sort of geometrically non-commutative deformations. And the second summand here corresponds to commutative deformations. And so this is a finite dimensional vector space of dimension k minus 1. And this here is actually infinite dimensional over C, over the field, but it's finitely generated as a module of global functions on the resolution, which is also the functions on the on the singularity. Okay, and so you can prove this either geometrically using check homology, maybe also use the toric methods, or again also via the reduction systems from the algebra A. And as in the case of P2, the isomorphism given by tilting allows us to relate co-cycles for this description via reduction systems to sort of co-cycles on the geometric side of the calculation via check homology, for example, and also correspondingly the deformations you obtain from these co-cycles when they're unobstructed, you can interpret them then geometrically. So you have algebraic deformations of this algebra A, and they have sort of two types, which correspond to commutative deformations on the geometric side, or to some sort of quantizations of Poisson structures. And so for the commutative deformations, these turn out to be and correspond to PBW deformations, which were studied by Crawley, Bovey, and Holland in their paper on pre-projective algebras. And then Karmazin also studied these in a bit more generality of these 1 over k, 1 n singularities. And so just to give an idea again, what we should expect is that if gamma is in SL2C, then the resolution admits a symplectic structure. So for 1 over k, 1, 1, that means that k should be equal to 2. So 1 over 2, 1, 1, this is admits a symplectic structure. And for k bigger or equal to 3, this will not admit a symplectic structure anymore, because then this is not an element in, sorry, the group gamma is not in SL2C anymore. And the PBW deformations of this algebra A that we're trying to describe, the PBW deformations correspond to commutative deformations of the resolution, as well as quantizations of the symplectic structure. So somehow the PBW deformations, in this case, when we are in SL2, we also get something that geometrically we would expect to be non-commutative. Okay, and so for this 1 over k, 1, 1 singularity, we can again choose co-cycles, which I now call alpha 1 up to k minus 1, it should be here, sorry, k minus 1, from HOM CS to A. So we choose the co-cycles to correspond to a basis of these, of this summand in the Hochschild, Kost, and Rosenberg decomposition. And then we can see that the associated element G here is now a Maurer-Cartan element of this L infinity algebra PQR. And now we've tensored with this ideal, because we have k minus 1. So this is the maximal ideal of the polynomial of formal power series in these k minus 1 coordinates. And it turns out that under this choice, these this element G gives a formal deformation, which also admits an algebraization, as we saw in the last talk. And the reason is that this is a PBW deformation in this case. And so here we've added on, or we subtract here, E0 Tj. And so E0 is a shorter path than X0 Yj. And so since a path of length 2 to a path of length 0 on all elements of S, and so it satisfies this condition, strictly smaller on the path length, and we get an algebraization. And then if we evaluate this algebraized deformation at some constants, we obtain a Malcarton element of the non-formal L-infinity algebra, and the associated algebra to this is then Morita equivalent to its center whenever lambda is non-zero. And what do we get? We get a commutative deformation of the singularity. Yeah, which is also a commutative deformation of the resolution, in fact. So if you deform the resolution in this case, you start with a quasi-projective variety, which is not affine, but as soon as you deform in any commutative direction, you get an affine variety, and the functions on this affine variety is exactly, these are the commutative deformations of the singularity. Right, and then we can also look at the non-commutative deformations. And so when for this one over k, one singularity, again, if k is bigger or equal to 3, then the associated cyclic group is not a subgroup of SL2C, but only subgroup of GL2C. And now we can choose 3 cocycles corresponding to the generators of the Poisson structures. So I said this was a infinite dimensional, but it's a module over the global functions. And we can choose generators also on the side of the deformations of the reduction systems. And so when we do this, we see that this is again a Malcarton element. So here now we have 3 formal variables corresponding to these 3 generators. We use 3 formal variables T0, T1, T2. And this is a Malcarton element of this L-infinity algebra. And in fact, if we throw out either beta 0 or beta 2, then the order condition that was mentioned in the last talk also allows us to give an algebraization of the associated formal deformation in this case. And so the point is that the G takes a path of length 2 here, but maps it to a path of length 2. So it does not satisfy this strictly lower condition, but it satisfies the sort of admissible order condition that it's smaller with respect to some order you can choose on the paths. And so then also the reductions become finite. So the formal star product actually is just a finite sum in this case. And yeah, and you have this this result that this algebraic family gives a family of deformations corresponding to some degenerate Poisson structures on the resolution. Okay, so I will close with mentioning sort of one observation here, which is that if you have a quiver, you can look at moduli space of quiver representations for some stability condition and some dimension vector. And so Karmazin has shown that that a variety X, which admits a tilting bundle, can actually be recovered as the moduli space of semi-stable representations of this quiver with relations. And so the quiver with relations is the one that's associated to the tilting bundle T. And so this M here is the moduli space of semi-stable representations. And so if you choose the dimension vector and the stability condition correctly, you can recover the variety. And he also showed in a different paper, I think, that that the tilting bundle actually lifts to a commutative deformation of X. So let me say what you then get in case of the 1/k 1-1 singularity. So you can find that when you deform the ideal corresponding to a commutative deformation. So here I lambda is a deformation of the ideal, deformation of the algebra that corresponds to a commutative deformation, commutative direction. So lambda here is in H1 of the tangent. Then you have this isomorphism that the fibers of this family are actually the deformations of the resolution. So the resolution deforms, and then you can check that the moduli space for some dimension vector and stability condition is isomorphic to the deformation. And what's also interesting is that that in the non-commutative case, you can deform the algebra non-commutatively. So you change the ideal, in this way here. And when you evaluate this, you get again an algebra with the same basis. And the moduli space for the same dimension vector and same stability condition now doesn't give it still gives a commutative variety, because the moduli space is a quasi-projective variety. And this variety is actually exactly the degeneracy locus of the Poisson structure that you use to deform this ideal. In order to make sense of the statement, we sort of used the existence of an algebraization, which allowed us to get an actual algebra here with an actual ideal, which is an actual deformation of the algebra. Okay, and let me just also mention that when the resolution admits a symplectic structure, then the symplectic structure is non-degenerate, and indeed the moduli space for this for the same stability condition and the same dimension vector is empty in this case. Yeah, so this is sort of an example of what sort of thing can happen if you fix the quiver and the dimension vector and the stability, but you vary the relations in the quiver, because usually one can look at like variation of stability structures and understand what happens in this case. But this is an example of what can happen when you vary the relations in the quiver, what happens to the modular space of quiver representations. Okay, and this concludes the last talk. Thank you very much for making it to the end of the last talk.